present the first speaker and the symposium about non-functional treatment of CRS, Professor Lewin. 20 minutes each.
Perfect. Talk. It's wonderful.
So, your time.
Yes.
Thank you.
So, good morning to everybody. I think the room is not full, but I think you are interested, and that's the most important thing. Well, I got the topic, and I would like to thank the ERS committee to get all the options for presenting here yesterday the master dissection, today this topic. And I will introduce a little bit to the history about FES, because we are starting today with the presentations. And when we talk about FES, we should as well talk about the early history and the development. And I would say the title could be as well Messerklinger's and Stamberger's legacy. So what's about the concept of functional endoscopic sinus surgery? When you look in the literature, you will find a very interesting paper which was published 2 years ago by Kevin Kane, and he wrote nice things about how the history, how the early history and development of functional endoscopic sinus surgery was. Well, I don't know if you know that Walter Messerklinger, he was the man who, you know, developed or found out with his research staining in post-mortem specimens which were still having cilia. They were beating for another 48 hours, and he stained the mucus, and he could detect that the mucus was transported always to the natural ostium of the maxillary sinus. And this is a video clip. You can see it here very nicely by the white staining of the mucus. This video was given to me by Heinz Stamberger in 2017. So, well, Messerklinger in the early 60s operated in a near bloodless field. Can you imagine? Tailored surgery to each individual, depending on the pathology, why to establish normal ventilation, and he was, with his surgery, minimalistic in nature and concept. And may I ask you, who ever had the book of Walter Messerklinger to read it? Could you raise up your hands? Nobody. Okay, I'm very lucky. So because I have the book of Messerklinger and Stamberger, and I will show you a bit more. So in 72, Messerklinger introduced the endoscope as a method for diagnosis and therapy. And in 78, Messerklinger published the book Endoscopy of the Nose and Urban Schwarzenberg Press. And my, it's not working. I don't know why. Okay, I'll go on. And there was not very much interest in this book, and this was surprising. Further, Messerklinger developed the theory that major sinuses, such as the frontal and maxillary sinus, were dependent sinuses, and namely dependent on a clear anterior ethmoid cell structure in the middle majors. And he did, in his book, Endoscopy of the Nose, published 78, no interest in the English-speaking countries. Can you believe? And he made this very nice drawings and tried to make very precise descriptions about the anatomy. Well, Stamberger noted in his book, it was published 1990 with the title Functional Endoscopic Sinus Surgery, the Messerklinger technique changed operations on the frontal sinus into operations on the frontal recess and operations on the maxillary sinus into operations on the ethmoidal infundibulum. And I'm lucky because I have as well this book, and I tell you, whenever you get the chance, try maybe to get it over the internet. Maybe there are some examples there. We have to mention as well, besides Messerklinger and Stamberger, early pioneers like Wolfgang Graf. I think he was the pioneer in Germany, and you are familiar with his name. And he published this book at the same time like Messerklinger published his book. And the focus was here the maxillary sinus. And Malte Wiegand, he was an early pioneer and working in Erlangen. And he was fighting for the endonasal approach treatment of inverted papilloma. And Pierre Rovary from Arles in France, he was as well an early pioneer. And of course, you know David Kennedy. David Kennedy attended in 1984 a conference where Messerklinger talked in German. He didn't talk German, David Kennedy, but David Kennedy was so much impressed by the photos and by the illustrations of Walter Messerklinger that he took it, and he was like Stamberger, then decades later, traveling around the world and made FES popular. So this is one out of many photos out of the book of Walter Messerklinger. And why do I show you this? Because when you look here, that's the natural ostium of the maxillary sinus. And he stained the mucus transport here. And however, it was Messerklinger who emphasized that surgery should be directed towards providing clear drainage and ventilation via the natural ostium of the sinuses, and hence be functional. So this was the moment when the concept of functional endoscopic sinus surgery, FES, was born, and this is the title of my presentation. Now, finishing now my introduction with the history and coming a bit to literature, what can we find next to the books of Messerklinger and Stamberger? And when you go in the internet and you give the keywords functional sinus surgery, and you start here in 78 when the book of Messerklinger was published, you see there's an immense, you know, increase of papers coming out dealing with this topic. So it was accepted in the world. And for me, the best paper you can find next to the book of Messerklinger and Stamberger is this paper published by Stamberger and Posawetz about functional endoscopic sinus surgery, concepts, indications and results of the Messerklinger technique. And have a look here. Stamberger talked about indications, about different types of sinus disease. He talked as well and showed and published the results, the outcome and follow-up time from 8 to 10 years already in 1989. This is a long time ago. And I tell you, I mean, this is valid up to date. And of course, you know, Witzke Fockens and the team around her published in the EPOS document, I think, the knowledge of the last 40 years, the most important one. I think it's over 100 pages long, and I think you can download it very easily. So if you want to go more in detail, just get this one here. Now coming to a more practical part, just to show you about the concept of FES and the concept of non-FES, and I try to show it very simple. Seeing is believing, that's my philosophy. How should we do FES? I had the opportunity yesterday to do a 2-hour dissection here, and I'm very happy because we had 200 attendees, and I hope it was fine and you could learn a little bit. I was fighting with the mucosa, so I didn't want to strip, but for demonstration's sake, I did it in some steps, so I apologize again. Now, have a look at this case. I think for an experienced surgeon, maybe it's not a difficult case. But what do we have? We have here some anatomical variants, contia bullosa, but the problem is on the left side. We have here a slight septal deviation. We have here a nice cell, which is, I think, sitting over an Aganasi cell, the most important cell to approach the frontal sinus. And how would you name this cell? What would you say? It's a, could be a supra aga, because it's going a little bit over the here, the beak, a supra aga frontal cell. And what's here? It's a nice teeth or osteoma. Okay, osteoma. Okay, so it's to show you what I understand under functional surgery. So I'm just switching to the 45 degree endoscope, frontal recess, most narrow part, working around the corner, complex anatomy sometimes, non-forgiving area, you know, Van Alea who published this. Now we are going with the proper instruments here, like the through cutting, I call it crocodile, I used it yesterday as well, sucking, orientation, controlling bleeding, now going up with the circular mushroom punch. And you do delicate surgery, you spare mucosa and even bony structures. You don't have to tear out everything. Yes, this bony lamellas, you take it out. Now you make a delicate dissection. You try to find out what happens. It's not a broad attachment of the osteoma. There's only a punctional, like a pedicle. And as you can see here, I just try to lift it, to mobilize it a little bit more, and then I take it out with the proper up-bended instruments. And of course, yes, I did a little bit more exposure here. It's up there. Now, this is the end of surgery. Yes, this is no osteoma. This is, I don't think you have to drill out this. And how does it look like post-op? Yes, this is the way, how does it look like? I don't care about this. This is not looking like something which is growing. For me, this is functional surgery, a functional concept. So what to avoid and how not to do FES? Ethmoid sinus. This young lady, 23 years old, I still have 10 minutes or 8, opacification, frontal sinus, ethmoid sinus. You have here something which is, you know, not looking very nice. She was operated 4 times on the sinuses, 23 years old. Pain, blockage, recurrent infections. How does it look like? This is the middle meatus. This is, for me, non-functional surgery. You have here polyp. Yes, of course, this can happen. But what's going on here? It seems to be a part of the middle turbinate. I go on, I show you the video clip. Now, trying to make a non-functional to a functional surgery or a case. And this is the middle turbinate. Here it was lateralized. There was some synechia formation. And this is a part of the middle turbinate. Now, you have to try to, you know, to bring the middle turbinate in the right position, maybe to save or to not to cut the middle turbinate away, getting access to the ethmoid cavity. You have to clean it. That's a remnant of the onset process. It's an older video clip. That's why the resolution is not so high, but I think it's a very good case. Now we are clearing here the anterior ethmoid cavity, taking the polyp. Now this here is natural ostium of the maxillary sinus. And this is a remnant of the middle turbinate. And there was a cut through here. I think you cannot save this part of the middle turbinate. And usually it's not part of the Messerklinger and Stumberger technique to resect turbinates, but I'm talking about a non-functional concept. This is natural ostium of the maxillary sinus. It is just exposed, not more. Going up with a 45 degree endoscope to the outward tract of the frontal, there's no need to make big openings, just enlargement. Yeah? And this is end of surgery, a little bit coagulation because maybe there could be some bleeding. And this is way up into the frontal sinus. Now, I think we got a more functional concept, even in this initially non-functional operated patient. This is post-op, and you see, we could spare, we could save the middle turbinate. Yes, we had to resect this part because there was a risk of re-lateralization. This is the exposure of the natural ostium of the maxillary sinus, and usually we don't make the big openings. Maxillary sinus ostium. I was operating, I corrected a missed ostium. Pay attention what I did. I don't blame others, it's my case. I used a 40 degree Blakesley. I tried to, you know, solve the problem with the missed ostium, but pay attention now, pay attention here. With doing this, I was tearing the mucosa from the posterior wall of the maxillary sinus and the roof of the maxillary sinus here, close to the infraorbital nerve. Then I tried to replace the mucosa, it's not always working very nicely. You see here the intraorbital nerve, and I think this is not functional. I did the operation, so, well, this is right after the operation, coming now to the 1 month post-op, and the patient had severe crusting, and she was really suffering, and she was coming at the emergency case in the hospital because of pain here. This is now the wound healing. I think we were finally lucky because it healed nicely. It's initially a non-functional concept, as you can see here. However, when you see this, yes, we are lucky because we could re-establish ventilation and drainage and the patient was fine. But as long as you operate delicate, I think you won't have a problem. 5 minutes to go, so have a look here. This patient was operated 3 times on her sinuses. I can't see any pathology and she was still symptomatic. Do you know why? Well, when you exactly look here, there are remnants of the Hansnip process in place, like here. I think you have heard about the missed ostium sequence, and when I'm in Graz at the FEST course, I always talk about this minimal invasive maximal effect when you correct this. Have a look at the video clip. Mega ostium, I don't know why, this is no functional surgery, but we have to deal with this patient because she is symptomatic, having all this mucus in her throat. And have a look here, it's exactly here. We can't see it now. You have to use a 45 degree endoscope and taking a ball probe tip. Why? Because that's a remnant of the Hansnip process, and behind you will definitely see the natural ostium of the maxillary sinus. It's there. And if you leave it, the patient won't be happy. She will still be symptomatic. So what is the plan? You dissect the remnants of the Hansnip process delicately. You work around the corner with your proper endoscope and your proper instruments, like the 90-degree bended vial, and now backbiting instrument, and that's some little remnants of the Hansnip process. You can flip it away, you can take it away, very delicate. And finally, now we have a nice view on the natural ostium, 90-degree Blakesley. Again, pay attention, not tearing mucosa, a through-cutting would be maybe better. And now I take it, making one bite, and this was before the other case, so next time I don't do it. I didn't tear too much, but you know, you see, tearing mucosa is what we want to avoid. This is the final situation. Risk of big openings is cessation of mucociliary clearance, drying effect, but finally we got the function back and the patient was fine. Before operation and right after operation. Frontal sinus. We know that the agonase cell and the Hansnip process, the most important structures to get access to the frontal sinus. Here, a blocked frontal sinus. And this is not really functional surgery, because as soon as you go in this area, you have to dissect in a very atraumatic way this bony structures. Otherwise, you will have problems. And this is as well no functional concept. When you have a patient and you leave this, I think, nice cell lamella, it's a supra-aga-frontal cell, a large one, and I will show you this video clip. And this patient was operated having some synechia, and now we are looking with a 45 degree endoscope in the frontal sinus, and now we are dissecting the posterior wall of this supra-aga-frontal cell. And by getting the posterior wall, you are allowed to take out the mucosa of this cell, because you want to remove the blockage of the frontal sinus. And this is the classical example for uncapping the egg, and you know this is the Graz description for how to do this kind of surgery. And I like this example because it shows nicely this big bony lamella. We are looking in the frontal sinus. Yes, you can make a little bit more, you know, polish, but not, don't do too much. This is the end of surgery. How does it look like post-op? Always look for your post-op results. 2 months, a little bit granulation here. Frontal sinus is fine and patient was happy. Now, coming to in the literature published non-functional concept. I appreciate a lot what Klaus Bachert and his group is doing, and I just want to stimulate discussion. For me, this is what he published in this paper. It was in 2019, and this is a non-functional concept. Maybe it works in some patient. He describes that he tears out all the mucosa in the TH2 patient who are recalcitrant and not responding to all the surgical procedures. He wants to take out all the mucosa along here and leaves the red mucosa inside. So I'm not sure. This is, for me, definitely, when I'm coming from Messerklinger-Starnberger, a non-functional concept without any description about if it helps. And you see here how he's doing it. He's doing a median drainage and so on. Let me show you something else, which is maybe as well a so-called reboot. This patient, my last patient, then I conclude, 6 times previous surgery, semtertride, asthma, recurrent nasal polyp, white out. Patient is really suffering. Now, this is what I got by my operation. I did another re-type 3 according to EFES G6 operation. This was 1 month after the operation. You see slightly there's still edema, polyp, inflammation, 2 months. 3 months with dupilumab biologicals. Patient could breathe again, no asthma, no problems. And this was 1 year later. Have a look here. I think this is for me the modern reboot, and I'm not sure about the surgical reboot system. So in a nutshell, these both, Messerklinger and Starnberger, published the best books I ever wrote. I'm very interested in this. So, and what is the concept about FEST in the past, as well present and for the future? Despite the fact we have dupilumab, preservation of structures, re-establishment of function by preserving mucous membrane to remove as little as possible, to preserve as much as possible, both bony structures covering membranes, stated as conditio sine qua non for rapid and certain recovery. This is a pre-word of Sabine Wulstein in the book of Professor Starnberger. And the goal is to arrange the surgical and functional aspect to the individual case. And let me make one last slide here. I'm very much privileged because I'm absolutely happy that I got to know Heinz Starnberger and I worked so close to him. And I think we should mention him, that he did very much for our profession. Thank you very much.